Because the church goes beyond the preacher. The church goes beyond the choir. The church goes beyond the position. The church is all about Jesus Christ. Listen, at this time we're going to hear another selection from our ensemble, our group, and then following that, we'll have the message for the hour. Amen.
You've been so good to us, you've been so kind to us, And so we love you, Jesus. And so we give you glory. And so we give you honor. Because you're worthy. Oh, you're worthy, Lord.
You are worthy.
Yes, you are. The Lord, and he was high and lifted up, and his train filled the temple. Won't you let him fill your heart this morning? Won't you let him fill your soul this morning? Some of us have yet to say good morning, Jesus. Would you tell him good morning, Jesus? Good morning, Jesus. We thank you for the rising of the sun, and we thank you for the going down of the same, Lord. We thank you for another opportunity to lift up holy hands, to concentrate on you, and give you worship because we love you that much. We love you that much. And so our soul make her boast in you. We say, Lord, you're wonderful. We say, Lord, you're kind. We say, Lord, you're worthy. You're deserving of the praise. And if we had 10,000 tongues, we could not praise you enough. And so we give you glory and we give you praise this morning. Somebody help us say, you're worthy, Lord.
You are worthy, Lord.
Give him glory this morning. Come on, because he's worthy. How many know he's worthy?
At this moment, we acknowledge that you are worthy of our praise. So often, God, we are quick to give others more praise than you. We are quick to acknowledge how they go out of their way. The things that they do to help us. But in a real sense, God, we would have nothing if it were not for you. And so, God, we want to say thank you and declare that you and you alone are worthy of our praise. You're worthy of our praise, God, because you've brought us through 2 years of this. You're worthy of our praise, dear God, because we're here right now. You're worthy of our praise because you woke us up this morning. We have life and health and strength because of you. may not have all that we want and all that we need, but God, with you, we have enough. And so therefore, Lord, we give you our praise. We praise you from our living rooms. We praise you from our pews. We praise you right here and right now and declare that you are worthy of our praise. And so now, dear God, as we move deeper into this worship experience, bless this word. Bless it as it goes forth so that we can see the significance of time, the significance of this moment. Center our thoughts on you. Settle our spirits so that we may not only be able to hear it, but live it. Bless those who are watching virtually. Bless our physical audience, dear God. Move as only you can move. And at the conclusion, if there's someone here who doesn't know you, if there's someone here that hasn't said yes to you, if there's someone here or who's watching who's not saved, I pray, God, that they just surrender who they are, cry out to you and say, Lord, come and live in my heart. Help them to understand that moment they can be saved. God, we praise you now. Have your way in and through this message. This is our prayer. And we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Come on, my brothers and sisters, let's give God another hand of praise. Throughout our virtual time together, we have been blessed. Oftentimes, my brother Hassan Smith, and he had to step out. He's got to get to his church. He comes and blesses us. Brother Hassan and Sister Joyce for taking time out to be with us. Amen. Sister Regina McLeod, who is the wife of our bass player. It's so funny. Every time Regina sings, Joe just hits that bass a little harder. You just play different. You play different when your wife is here. That's all I'm saying. That's all I'm saying. I don't know what does it. You got to go home. She okay. And then last but not least, Sister Alnisa Danberville for holding it down for us. God bless you. God bless you. God bless you. Matthew chapter 13 is where we are. Matthew chapter 13, verses 54 through 58. We're reading this morning from the Message Translation. The Message Translation. Amen. The Message Translation. But whatever you have, whether at home or here physically, follow along with us. Matthew chapter 13, beginning at verse 54, it reads this way. When Jesus finished telling these stories, he left there, returned to his hometown, and gave a lecture in the meeting house. He stole the show, impressing everyone. We had no idea he was this good, they said. How did he get so wise, get such ability? But in the next breath, they were cutting him down. We've known him since he was a kid. He's the carpenter's son. We know his mother, Mary. We know his brothers, James and Joseph, Simon and Judas. All his sisters live here. Who does he think he is? They got all bent out of shape. Verse 58, but Jesus said, a prophet is taken for granted in his hometown and his family. He didn't do many miracles there because of their hostile indifference. I want to focus on verse 58. The last part of that, he didn't do many miracles there because of their hostile indifference. This morning, my brothers and sisters, I want to share with you both physically and virtually from this subject. Make the most of your moment. Make the most of your moment. Let me read this quote from you. As we're celebrating Women's History Month, Maya Angelou, she says these words. I have great respect for the past. If you don't know where you've come from, you don't know where you're going. I have great respect for the past. But I'm a person of the moment. I'm here. And I do my best to be completely centered at the place I'm at. And then I go forward. Forward to the next place. The words of Maya Angelou. We're here. We are here. Some are here physically, some are watching by live stream, but we're here. Both physically and literally, we're here. After 2 years of this, we're here. The beginning of service, I've called out the names of those who are no longer here, but we are here. Here, here, meaning that literally we have made it through these tumultuous times. We're here. But then also, not only are we here literally, but we're here physically. Some of you, those of you who are present in the sanctuary, you are here. You're not at home, you're here. And to those of you who are watching, you are there. But we're still here in worship. We're here in worship, 2 years later, we're here in worship, 2 years of not knowing what the future would look like, but yet we're here. And so I wanted to share this message because we're slowly going to get back to fully reopening. And I want to give a word of advice to those who can't wait to get back. When you get back here physically, make sure you make the most of the moment. This past week, I've spent time reading about how we think and process and operate. And what I realize is many of us can never take advantage of the moment because we're stuck reflecting and replaying the past. And so we have arrived here at this moment, but some are still replaying what happened last week and what happened a month ago and what happened over the 2 year period. We're constantly replaying COVID and illnesses and surgeries and death. We're constantly replaying breakups and divorces, and eviction notices, and job losses. We're constantly replaying children not doing right, constantly replaying elections from 2020, constantly replaying the insurrection at the Capitol. We're constantly replaying the former president and his craziness. We are constantly stuck in the past. And I'm here to remind you that if you stay focused on the past for too long, that you will fail to appreciate what is happening in your moment right now. That's not only individually, but that's collectively. If we constantly talk about what the church used to be like and how it used to be filled and how we used to do certain things, if you constantly replay what you used to do, you'll fail to understand the significance of this moment right now. And if you are not free enough to see God in this moment, and if you can only see God in your past experiences, in your past form of worship, then you honestly don't understand who God is. Because I want somebody to know that God is a God of moments. God is a fluid God. God is not a stagnant God, and God is not a God of the past. God is a God of the past, the present, and the future. And so, therefore, I want to be in my moment. How many opportunities have passed us by because we've been focused on the past? Can't appreciate where I am right now because I keep talking about the past and what happened to me. Listen, Maya says, I've got respect for the past. Because if you don't know your past, you don't know where you are, you don't know where you're going. She says, but I've also learned that I want to be present in the moment. I want to be in the here and now, because I believe that the same God, I'm talking for Maya and myself, the same God that did it in my past is the same God that can do it right now. And I don't want to miss my moment. Oftentimes we miss our moments constantly reflecting on the past, the good old days. I'm over the good old days. And people who know me, you know that during COVID, I've had a shift. I've had a shift. No disrespect to the past, but I've been through some things and I've seen some stuff. And honestly, I'm at the point now where life is too short for me to keep talking about the past. By the grace of God, God has me in this moment, not my past moment. And so therefore, if God has blessed me in my past and God has brought me to this moment, then I will praise God right now at this moment for who God is. Don't miss your moment. Don't miss the moment. We're focused on the past, but then also we're filled with anxiety about the future. Many of us miss our moment right now because you're thinking about tomorrow. You're thinking about the surgery. You're thinking about the job, the manager, the boss. You fill in the blanks. You can't appreciate where you are right now because you're constantly thinking about what's ahead. But during these 2 years, there were some people who planned for what's ahead and didn't get to see it. And so I'm here to remind somebody that, yes, biblically, we are to prepare for the future, but don't miss your moment right now. Some of us can't appreciate the good times right now because you can't wait for stuff to happen in the future. I say this jokingly, but I mean it in sincerity. I've had folk ask me, like, when we gonna open up? So I gave them a date. Come March 20th, we'd be here. Okay, when we gonna open up completely? I said, hold on. You ain't even made it to the March 20th, but you already, when we gonna open up? Now, I wanted to say, I didn't say it. I told you I've changed. But I wanted to say, and when you show up, will you bring something to the fire? Will you bring some praise? Or are you just here because it's open again? I'm not in the business of being open any longer. When these doors are open, we are here to worship the Lord. I'm here to praise God. I ain't here for nothing else. You can keep it. You can have it. Because God hasn't brought us through these 2 years of a pandemic for us to return to an old form of worship. God says, did I not bless you during COVID? Did I not watch over you and your family? Did I not make a way for you? So therefore, at this moment, not next week, not next month, not last month, but right now, can you praise me for this moment? As a matter of fact, somebody needs to thank God right now for this moment. Let's take a praise break, virtually and physically. Can you thank God for this? Stand up in your living room. Praise God for right now. Look at all that God has done. Touch yourself. You're still here. You can miss your moment. I just want us to start appreciating our moments. Because if you don't appreciate the moment will pass you by. Jesus has come back home. He left his family at 30 to begin this ministry. He left after being raised by Joseph and Mary, playing with his siblings. But now his moment had come. It had arrived. He left home. Was led into a wilderness. He was baptized and led into a wilderness. After the wilderness, found himself teaching on the hillside of Capernaum. One of the greatest messages ever taught and preached was the Sermon on the Mount. The awareness of who he was and the authority that he had in teaching was beginning to spread. And I'm sure it reached back home. You know, word travels fast. Listen, I've learned during COVID. You know, folk, you know, we would have announcements period at the church. Announcements always go on. It's always somebody calling with an update. What's going on? Who is doing this? It's the same 2,000 years ago. I heard Jesus was in Capernaum. Heard he had thousands at his feet, and he was teaching them. There's something going on with him. They heard about him. They heard about the paralyzed who could now walk. The blind who could now see. Heard about a woman with an issue of blood who had been healed. Jairus' daughter, who was dead, brought back to life. They heard. Heard the testimonies, the rumors. Rumor report was a man was lowered down in a house on a mat. And Jesus had him get up and walk out the house on his own two feet. They heard it was a storm at the sea. He told the winds to be quiet. Heard it was two crazy men living out in the cemetery. Heard he came up and talked to them. And the demons that was in them was cast into some pigs. And the pigs committed suicide. They heard about Jesus. And in the 13th chapter, verse 54, their moment arrives. He had done for others out there, but now he's home. And he shows up to give them what he's been giving to others. Their moment has arrived. Jesus shows up, and the Message translation says he's teaching at the meeting house with authority. They see him teaching. They've heard about his miracles, and they are in awe for a minute. But then the mind got the best of them. You miss your moment when you allow your mind to stray away from what it should be focused on. All it takes is one thought, and your mind is gone, and you've just lost focus. Jesus is in their presence. He's teaching them, and they are in awe for a moment. But then the next moment, their mind starts saying, but hold up. Who does he think he is? That ain't nothing but the carpenter's son, Mary's son. We know his brothers. His sisters live right here. And at that moment, their moment was passing them by. They're standing face to face with the one who could change their lives, but they missed their moment. And how many of us are sitting in the pews or sitting on our lazy boys or our sofas and you're crying because you missed your moment? You wishing you had another opportunity. Can't tell you the number of people who talk about, I miss my bride. I missed my husband 20 years ago. 20 years has passed, and you still talking about somebody 20 years ago. I should have taken that job. Missed moments. The thing about missed moments is that when we begin to focus on missed moments, we fail to recognize God in the present. Because what I love about God, and this is my shouting point, what I love about God is, I was about to say bad enough, God is awesome enough to allow me to have missed moments of my past, but then also give me new opportunities in my future. Just a real quick question, is there anybody that has ever had a missed moment, but God gave you another opportunity? In spite of your missed moment, you better give God some praise at home and right here, because we serve a God that is big enough to bring it back around. And so I want somebody this morning, those here, those watching, I want you to make the most of your moment. I want you to make the most of your moment. How do we do that? First and foremost, if I'm looking at this text, you've got to acknowledge what he's done. You have to acknowledge what he's done. Watch this. Don't talk about what you've been through. Acknowledge what he's done. Changes of perspective. Don't talk about what you went through, what you've gone through, the obstacles you had to go through. Acknowledge what God has done. That changes my whole perspective about COVID. Yes, people died. Yes, I had it twice. Yes, I had to go through some stuff. Yes, I had to wear masks. But by the grace of God, he brought me through it. That's the thing. How many of us talk about what we went through instead of what God did? The people, listen, the people knew what he did. They just didn't acknowledge it. How often do we come into worship and we don't acknowledge what Christ has done? Talk about what you went through. Talk about how hard it was. Can you talk about Jesus? Can you talk about the one who got you here? Listen, listen, you've got to acknowledge, acknowledge what he's done. Let me say this. This past week, I was watching, Deion Sanders has this documentary about his life as a coach at Jackson State University. It's a series. I stumbled upon it on YouTube. I just watched the episode in which Deion had his toes amputated. And he hadn't seen it. He had gone through 30 days of just torture. And the doctors are unwrapping his leg after surgery from the knee down. And as they unwrap it, he looks at it and he tears up. And the next thing he said was, "Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord." Now, I'm confused. I get it. But in my mind, I'm focused on his past. Stay with me. Because I'm focused on not Deion Sanders, but I'm focused on prime time. That's what he's known as. I'm focused on him being a two-star athlete, both in football and baseball. It was those legs and feet that stole bases. Those legs and feet that intercepted passes and took them to the house. Those legs and feet that danced in end zones. That's what I'm focused on. So as I'm looking at what he's looking at, I'm not saying thank you, Lord. I'm focused on his past. Because based upon what I see, he ain't gonna be able to do in the future what he did back then. But Deion is looking at the foot and the leg, half of his leg has been chopped off. And he's saying, "Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord." I watched that video a few times and God began to speak to me and say, you need to help folk understand that the source of his praise is not based upon his past and what he was able to do back then. But the source of his praise is, as he looked at that foot and that mangled leg, he realizes that he could have been gone. You'll catch that later. You realize it could have been the whole foot, not the toes. You realize he could have lost his whole leg and his life. And so as he's looking at his mess, he is acknowledging that God had a hand in this. I wish somebody could help me understand that when you go through stuff, it may look like a mess and it may be painful, but you better acknowledge what he's done because he's been there. They acknowledge what he did. If you're going to make the most of your moment, you've got to acknowledge what he has done, but then you need to appreciate his presence. You need to appreciate his presence. You need to appreciate the fact that he's there. He's there. I laugh at this text now. Jesus shows up there. Out of all the places that he could be, he's there with them. But they don't appreciate the fact that he's there. I'm sorry. Woo! How many times do we go through what we go through and we fail to appreciate that we got company. How many times have we gone through obstacles and arguments? Have we gone through firings and hirings and failed to realize that he's there? How many times have you gone in the surgery room and the anesthesia is being placed over you and you fail to acknowledge and recognize that he's there? I want somebody to know that Christ is there all the time, and you ought to appreciate his appearance. That's why this worship is important for me. Hybrid worship is important because he's shown up in my house over the 2 years. But when I come to the church house, I want to appreciate his presence in the house. And some of us have failed to appreciate that Christ is in the house. We're too busy looking at who's not here or who should be here. But the only one that matters is the one that woke me up this morning. The one who kept me through COVID. The one who brought me to where I am. The one who cleared my mind. And he's here right now. And I wanted him to know that I appreciate him. I want Jesus to know that I love him so much. Because he could be somewhere else. But he's here with me in spite of my mistakes. In spite of my failures, in spite of my broken promises, he's still right here. Is there anybody that can give God praise for him being here right now? Don't miss your moment. Don't miss your moment. I'm done. We gotta go. Okay. That's about my time. It's about my virtual time. Listen, you gotta acknowledge what he's done. And then you need to appreciate his appearance. He's there. That's why I didn't have a problem. I know. Some like I had a problem. I didn't have a problem at worshiping at home. Didn't have a problem. I know some say it's uncomfortable, but he had to show me, literally, that not only can I be here with you in a pulpit, but I can be there with you in your living room. That's what he showed me. I don't know what he showed y'all. I know. It's just too comfortable at home. But he had to show me that I am with you always. In every situation, I'm with you. I'm with you on a Sunday morning, and I'm with you on a Wednesday night. I'm with you on a Monday afternoon, and I'm with you on a Saturday morning. God says, I'm with you. Well, they couldn't acknowledge who he was and what he did. They failed to appreciate his appearance, him showing up. Lastly, and we're done. And the last thing is, they did not get the chance to allow Jesus to do what he wanted to do. It's all in the text. They missed a moment. Verse 58, he came to do some stuff for them. But because of their unbelief, I think the New International Version says, their unbelief, I believe the message says, their hostile indifference to Jesus. Their hostile indifference. I wonder if we have any hostile indifferent worshipers. Hostile indifference means that I'm going to sit there with my arms folded and I really ain't concerned about what you do. Hostile indifference means I can watch you at any time because it really ain't going to make a difference in my life. Jesus says, I am showing up right now. And if you fail to acknowledge me and fail to appreciate that I'm here with you, I can take what I have for you. I was going to title this When Jesus Gave the Peace Sign, but I figured that was a little too much. But I see him looking at the worshipers. And he's saying to himself, I've showed up for my people because I haven't been here in a while. And once I showed up, they greet me with hostile indifference. I came to give them some breakthroughs. I came to give somebody deliverance. I came to give somebody healing. But they got focused on the wrong thing. They allowed their minds to look at what I am or who I came from. Instead of what I can do, they got preoccupied with how I sounded. They got preoccupied with my lack of education. They got preoccupied with what my mama did and my daddy did. that they missed their moment. They got preoccupied because they wanted proof. Did I really walk on water? Was the paralyzed really paralyzed? Could the blind really see out of one eye? They got distracted on the wrong thing, and because they missed their moment, Jesus says, I'm going to take what I have and I'm going to the next town. I don't want to miss my moment. I don't want to miss my breakthrough. I don't want to miss my deliverance. And so when Jesus is in me, I want him to do whatever you feel like doing, however you feel like doing. If I have to wait on you, I'll wait on you. If I have to be by myself, I'll be by myself. But they that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength, mount up with wings as eagles, run and not get weary, walk and not faint, wait on the Lord. My brothers and sisters, to those of you physically, to those of you who are watching virtually, don't miss your moment. Make the most of your moment right now. If you are here, if you are watching, make the moment right now. Give God praise and worship God for who God is right now, because tomorrow is not promised. God, we thank you. Thank you for this service. Thank you, dear God, that as we've gathered on our 2-year anniversary, we acknowledge what you've done. Not only in our personal lives, but in the world. We acknowledge, God, that you are King of Kings and Lord of Lords. God, we thank you for showing up. Thank you for your appearance. And we ask your forgiveness if we've taken your appearance for granted, if we've taken your presence for granted, if we've become preoccupied with any and everything else except you being here. Thank you for being here. Thank you for being there with us every step of the way. And God, since you're here, have your way. Do what you're gonna do. We want to receive all that you have for us. And so God, we surrender who we are and we give our lives to you. We pray, dear God, for those who are watching that don't have a relationship. Will you bless them, God? Will you speak to them, allow them to open up their hearts so that they might allow you in and discover life brand new? Thank you for those who are worshiping with us in person. Thank you for our virtual audience. God, continue to be with us and guide us until our faith is forever lost in your sight. This is our prayer. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you, my brothers and sisters. Come on, let's give God some praise. Make the most of your moment. Make the most of your moment. Amen. All right. God bless y'all. Have a wonderful day. We'll see you in 2 weeks. First Sunday in April. We'll see you then. Amen.